Fats.
Morning, Mark.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good.
Yeah, I'm excited to do this one today. So
I am too. I just finished a portrait in graphite that I was hoping to try to figure out how to do it in watercolor, maybe trace it. Can I just flash it on the screen for you with my hand?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I could share screen, but I don't want to dominate the screen. So hopefully you can see this.
I say dominate.
You say dominate? Okay. Who was that? Who was that?
That was Gina.
That was Gina.
Hey, Gina. Let me pull it up. Okay, dominate time. Okay, there it is. Can you see it?
Yes, I can. Yeah.
So does that lend it? Let me see if I can zoom in a little bit. What? Does that lend itself to the assignment, do you think? Or is it too small? It's actually on 14 by 17 paper, right? Well,
I think that definitely works. Yeah.
I haven't tried to do this where I trace it and try to, you know, put it on watercolor paper or something different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, and I'm trying to just look at the source photo, and it looks like there's like a good amount of like value and color shift in there. So I think that would be a...
Are you seeing my source photo here?
Yeah, there's like a... Yeah, there it is. Small version. Yeah, I think that there's, you know, some interesting opportunities there to like explore some colors, and yeah, I think it would be fun to paint.
Okay, I'll give it a shot. Thank you for letting me ask you that.
Sure.
Thanks, Gina.
Okay.
Lori, this is Annette.
Hi, Annette.
I delivered my paintings to the theater and I saw yours. That's a lovely display. Great paintings.
Thank you. I didn't get over there. My husband did the delivery. I was in class. So he did the delivery and swap because I had the three portraits he was picking up. Uh-huh. I'm looking forward to going over and seeing the show.
Yeah, it's quite a gallery. I've never been there before.
Yeah, you know, they're going under construction, the whole theater.
There's nothing in June.
Probably nothing till September.
Construction will be a year from now. It was delayed.
Oh,
told me.
Okay. So this is the last show then for a while.
Well, they're coming in with an art group. I don't know who, some fine art group is coming in for them. The next one.
Oh, okay.
Okay. It's lots of changes. All right. Welcome, everyone. We'll go ahead and get started here. So there's a question, if I'm teaching next semester, and unfortunately I am not teaching at MiraCosta. I'll be doing some in-person teaching at some other schools that I work at, and I actually just picked up another class from another school, so I'm teaching at three different schools all at the same time. So
are they all in person?
They are all in person, yeah.
So you're not doing any online classes anywhere then?
No, I'm not. the time frame for like this class is right in the middle of like, you know, sort of the prime real estate for like teaching in person. So I can't like, I have to sort of commit to the one that pays the best, I guess, is the short story of that. But hopefully, you know, if my schedule permits, and then if the scheduling permits for MiraCosta, I might try to teach some more classes in the future. So we'll see. That being said, we've got two more weeks after this one. And this week we are continuing the painting that we started last week, which was just a drawing last week, but we'll jump into the painting portion of it here. And then next week, we've got another sort of more open-ended project, which is something that I've done for the last few semesters. And it's really just kind of approaching what you think about as subject matter and how you kind of deal with this idea of approaching beauty and aesthetics and all that stuff. But we'll cover that next week. So that'll be next week's issue. But this week, we've got some other stuff going on. And the content in the module is actually really brief. So we'll just sort of rush through that and then get into the painting. And that'll be that. So I'll go ahead and jump into that right now. And we can get started. Okay.
Good morning, Mark. This is Asha. Morning.
Yes.
I don't know, somehow my camera is not working in the computer. It says it's not powered to the computer. So I don't know how to do that. I don't know what's gone wrong here.
But you could see my screen, right?
Yes. Okay. Everybody's, I can see everybody and your screen as well. That's no problem. But just letting you know, my camera is not turning on.
Okay. I mean, that's, you know, unfortunate. But maybe during break, you could try unplugging it, plugging it back in. But at the very least, you're getting, you're still getting the instruction. And that's, yeah.
Right. Okay. Right. No problem. Thank you. Just letting you know. Thank you.
Sure. So, you know, I'm just going to start on this first page here. For me personally, when I was growing up, I wasn't really interested in fine art per se. It was not something that was necessarily the most accessible, you know, as a kid. You're not supposed to touch anything. Like, I remember walking into like the store, my mom would tell me to put my hands in my pockets so I'm not like running around and touching all the glass things in the store. And the same was true when we would go visit museums. It wasn't like we weren't exposed to those things, but it was kind of boring adult kind of stuff. And so the thing that really kind of interests me about art, or kind of made me interested in it to begin with, was comics. And I think that comics are an important medium to talk about, especially with like watercolor and the things that we've been doing with like the pen and ink. And I feel like there's a relationship there. And so comics were kind of the gateway to art making for me. And in fact, I had like really brief aspirations of becoming a comic book artist until I sort of realized that it was a lot of work, that those artists draw like every day for 8 hours a day. And they're just like, you have to be at sort of the top of your field to just even do it. You gotta be like the 1% of 1% to really be good at comic art.
Yeah, Mark, Do you know, like these days, is that still, the comics still drawn by hand, or do they use a lot of like computer?
Stuff? It's actually both. And I have some good examples of both techniques in this module. So we'll definitely get to that. But yeah, still drawn by hand. And sometimes it's, sometimes there's some computer manipulation. But even in that case, if we sort of make that distinction, with the computer, it's just as much a tool as, say, the pen and pencil. It's the way that they're manipulating the information on the computer isn't with like a mouse and a trackpad or like some algorithm. Although there's now this huge thing about like AI generated art that may create some hiccups in the industry. But still, like on the computer, they're using like a stylus, like a Wacom or some sort of like pen looking device. So they're drawing just like they would if they were using a pencil and pen. But when we talk about comics do something really differently than other visual art. When we look at paintings like in a museum or, most of the paintings that we've looked at over this course or the paintings that we're doing, they exist in a singular state. They are just that one single image. But comics do something different. They allow narrative to occur over the course of multiple images, right? So in a comic book or a comic strip, you have like a beginning, and then the next panel is like, say, the middle up until you hit the end. And so there's this structure of like images that occur simultaneously on the page, but create a time frame. And so what we call that is sequential art, meaning that there's a sequence to it. And Will Eisner is the creator of The Spirit and some other great comics, and there's a good video here on how he explains what sequential art is. He's sort of a master of creating sequence in art. So it's kind of a different device than we would normally see in, say, a painting. A painting, again, is just that kind of single image that has all of the content and all of the information loaded into it, whereas a comic is kind of made up and comprised of multiple images. And I know that sounds like, that makes sense. Like we've all seen comics in the newspaper or comic books if you read them. And so it's a pretty familiar thing. But sometimes I know some people, like my cousin, he can't read comics because he just jumps ahead. He has no like sense of flow to it. So there's kind of a lack of holding back. He's looking at the end before he looks at the beginning, and so that's kind of frustrating for him. And so that changes, if that's kind of your approach, that changes the way that you're interpreting the information. So there's a correct way to read comics, and I think that that's an important kind of understanding to have. There's a really good book. It's actually kind of boring, honestly. It's by Scott McCloud, and it's called Understanding Comics. And he explains how to read comics in comic form. To me, I don't like the book because it's intuitive. Like I said, I grew up reading comics. I read Mad Magazine, I read the comic strips, and then I started collecting comic books, and so it's always been around. So to me, it's like kind of preaching to the choir. But for some people, like it's a very enlightening book to read, Understanding Comics. Within the comics, we have like some basic ideas and some basic kind of devices that are utilized throughout the majority of comics. And the page or strip is made up of multiple images, and those images are within these little boxes. Sometimes they're not like literal boxes, and sometimes they are literal boxes, but each box is what we would call a panel. And so the panel indicates a single moment in time. So if we look here in this Incredible Hulk image here, you know, we've got the panel here indicated by this box, and then the next panel here indicated by this box. So we get a sense of like, this is happening, then this is happening. And in a Western culture, we read left to right. And so the comics read left to right and from top to bottom. So if we look at this first and then we look at this one second, you're like, yeah, that makes sense. But in for instance, like Japan, they read right to left. And they even, their books go from right to left. So if you're approaching it sort of opposite, like this panel first, then this panel, it would read like he's turning into the Hulk and then he has some like anguish versus being kind of like anguish and then turning back into Bruce Banner here from the Hulk. And so the culturally, we have to kind of be aware of how this shifts and how we read this and how we interpret that information or that sequence of events. And I have a little thing here on Japanese comics or manga, as it's called. And when they import those over to like Western audiences, they have to do a couple different things. They'll either mirror it, so they'll just print the whole thing kind of a mirror image and then make it go left to right, or they'll cut and paste it and then sort of resequence it so that it goes left to right, or they keep it the same and they force Western readers to read it right to left. So there's a big kind of shift towards keeping it original, and readers are now going from right to left when they read their Japanese comics. And if you've been to Barnes and Noble in the last like few years, that section, that manga Japanese comic section, it just gets bigger and bigger each year. It's the one area where all the kids are like sitting on the ground reading books inside the Barnes and Noble. And it's just getting more and more popular. And
is it translated into English?
It is, yeah. So the word, the text bubbles are translated to English, but the order is in the original order. So they're reading it from right to left. But yeah, it is translated into English. Good catch on that one. Yeah. In the comic, there are some sort of, like I said, devices that are generally used. And within the panel, we have like the image, but to move the story along, along with the image, we have sort of the devices of the narrative. And we've got word balloons. And so we have a word balloon here. And that's like that solid, oh, I don't have it. I got rid of that picture. We've got that solid thing with like the little indicator to who's speaking. We have a thought bubble, which is like a cloud with like bubbles. I don't have that image here. And that's like internal dialogue. And then we have a narrative box. And so this is like an omniscient third party that's narrating the story. So that's like this box here. And then we have sound effects, and that would be onomatopoeia. So like, you know, when people get punched, like in the opening credits for the Adam West Batman show, with like the pow and the blam, like those are sound effects. And so, you know, I just want to show a few variations of how we approach kind of reading comics. And this is kind of a low-res scan of the Sunday version of Calvin and Hobbes by Bill Watterson. And Watterson was like notoriously specific about how his comic strip was displayed, especially the Sunday one. The Sunday one, he wanted it to be kind of in this format. And a lot of times it would be condensed or kind of shifted for space, but he negotiated. And plus he was like one of the biggest comic strip artists with one of the most popular and influential comic strips, you know, short of Charles Schulz's Peanuts. He kind of was able to negotiate and make sure that, you know, Calvin and Hobbes looked the way that he wanted it to look. So here we've got Calvin, you know, and it's, again, it's weird for me to kind of explain how a comic works. But again, we read from left to right and top to bottom. So then as we get to the end here, we sort of reset and then we make our way back and then reset and make our way back. But in each panel is a new moment. It's a new sequence of events. And there's some period of time between here and here. And here and here. And so we get the sense of like, okay, he's, you know, building this mini snowman. And then he builds another mini snowman. And, you know, between here and here, we have a bigger jump of time that he's sort of accomplished lots of this, like, direct build snowman kind of thing. And then we have this idea, this realization, and then the resolution. This is a very succinct and kind of really great example of that sequence of events and the way that time kind of can extend or collapse depending on like the information that's being presented. So again, like this is a very short amount of time, and from here to here we have a big jump, and then you know, from here to here it seems like it's short again, and then he's like in action. And Watterson does a great job of using panel size to create that shift in time. So we've got these very kind of staccato moments of small panel, small panel, small panel, and then a big panel here.
Yeah, and, well, Mark, what's that last, you know, the one in the lower right?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't even seem like it belongs in this comic. I don't even know what it is. What,
okay, so it relates. So it's a dinosaur in a city eating people. And so it's a T-Rex, and then there's like people on the ground running away and like one in his mouth. And so that shift in kind of the visual language also is a bit jarring, and it creates a discrepancy between, you know, this very kind of serene moment with like the very stark background into this very busy moment. And that shift from here to here is jarring. And so what we're seeing is like, if we look at his face here, he's kind of like got a grimace and his teeth are exposed. And that kind of like translates to the teeth of the dinosaur here. So he's taking on the role of the dinosaur, and he's all of a sudden attacking all these little snowmen that he made, kind of within his own imagination.
So Mark, is that standard in comic that you have those panels like that with the space, or is that just this guy's?
So the space in between, or
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, so different artists will use different devices. They'll do different panel layouts. So depending on who the artist is, they can like have a lot of space here, or they'll be butted right up to one another, or there's no panels at all. So that's a totally kind of artistic interpretation of whatever kind of story it is. And that's a great kind of point to make, because that does also kind of create time and distance between moments. And so if we look at the next one, another Calvin and Hobbes here. I mean, Watterson is really like such a masterful artist. You know, in the first couple panels, we don't have any panels. We just have Calvin. We don't have like four Calvins all together. We just have different moments. And so that this is kind of like, you know, almost instantaneous. Like this is happening really quickly. Like here he is picking up snow, making a snowball, getting an idea, and taking off to go run. And now he's hiding behind a tree. And so that panel, you know, it freezes the action. And then we have another panel that's the same size. And again, it freezes that action. The tree is the same. Got another panel. Tree is the same. And so now we have this like longer kind of like punctuated moment. Whereas this was very sort of rapid fire. This feels like we're waiting and waiting, and each thing is waiting, and there's very little change. And so it makes us feel like things are taking too long. And now he's like kind of given up. And, you know, he's sort of frustrated, and all of a sudden there's like this action with the onomatopoeia here. And this breaks the edge. It's such a huge action that you know, that it's bigger than the other panels. And then we got the kind of culprit. Susie is, that's this character, and then Calvin's just mad at the world. And so he, you know, it, within this one comic we have that shift in kind of space and time and you know, and who's action. I think it's really good. What was that?
Who is Hobbes?
Oh, Hobbes. Hobbes is coming up right now.
I love this comic strip, and I actually named my first cat Hobbes.
Oh, that's great. Okay, so Hobbes is Calvin's pet tiger. It's actually, he's got a stuffed animal. And in his imagination, he's a fully realized and articulate tiger. So the tiger can like do things, and he has action and physicality and a whole other kind of personality. But it's his imaginary friend. And so in this one, we have Hobbes here. Putting on the record, you know, this is sort of the prep. And now we've got, you know, them dancing and 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 dancing. So that kind of lack of panel creates sort of a fluidity to the action. But there's also this really kind of amazing thing that Watterson does here that kind of goes unnoticed. You know, and then we have kind of his Calvin's parents sort of suffering from his antics here as like a punchline. But the thing that I want to point out is in this first panel, we've got Calvin and Hobbes. Second panel, we got Calvin and Hobbes, even though it doesn't have that panel. In this second line, you know, again, we don't have that panel. And if we start to look, like, you know, there's like some overlap of space, you know, that Hobbes is over here, Calvin's here. And then in this panel, it's Hobbes and Calvin, Hobbes and Calvin, Hobbes and Calvin, Hobbes and Calvin. So there's an equal number of both of them. But there's kind of a fluidity here, like Calvin's dancing with Hobbes here, or Calvin's dancing with Hobbes here. So it's not these two. It could be these two. Right? So where he's on kind of the right side, there's kind of a trick where all of a sudden he maybe shifts to the left side. And so here he's like shifting to the left side. It's not like he's jumping on his back. And then now he's shifting back over here to the right side. And then back over here to the right side. So the interaction and interplay between the panels becomes interesting and dynamic, that like this action is all over the place. And what he does to kind of reinforce that, in the second line, we have five tigers and five kids. But in this third line, we have four tigers and three kids. So he's doing this thing where all of a sudden those panel borders disappear and are indistinguishable. So the action and interplay between these is, we don't know anymore. Whereas this felt kind of orderly, right? Like these two, these two, these two, these two, and these two. We don't know how that's going anymore. And it's such a small little bit of information, or lack of information. But it suggests so much more. And that's, it's so great that would, and it gets kind of missed because you're fully engrossed with the activity. And that's why it's super effective. You know, there's also comics that kind of function in a single panel, and they're much more like kind of the way that a painting in a museum works, where all of the information kind of has to happen within that single moment. So we have, this is The Far Side by Gary Larson, and it is wacky. I don't know if any of you have read The Far Side. It is sort of crazy and but a lot of fun. And actually Larson retired years ago, but he just recently kind of got back into making comics again, or publishing the comics that he's made in the interim. And Bill Watterson also retired years ago, but is about to release something, and I don't know what it is, but at the end of the year there's something that he's made that is coming out, so I'm really excited to see what it is. But the difference between, you know, these two comic strips is, one, we have that kind of direct sequence, and this one we have that punctuated single moment.
Mark? Does that have a caption?
Sometimes his comics do have captions. This one doesn't. This is just the image by itself. One of his most popular ones is a comic called Cow Tools. Let me see if I have that. Here it is.
Mark, where is he coming? Where is he publishing his new ones?
I think they're online. So if you go to, like, I think thefarside.com, he's showing his new stuff there. And I think they're like weekly uploads. So this one was like published, and even to this day, it kind of like hounds him. People want explanations, you know, where the kind of the dinosaurs and the mammal is pretty direct. Like we understand it. We can kind of figure out, you know, the snow is falling, the dinosaurs are laughing at the the thing with the fur, and then this one kind of realizes it's about to get cold. That has a very kind of direct and clear thing. When Larson made this Cow Tools comic, people were confused. I mean, even to this day, people are confused. They're like, what is this? And it's just him being kind of silly, and there's no explanation. And so he has to kind of continually explain that it's just him being silly. So yeah, sometimes there's captions, sometimes there's dialogue. Sometimes it's just a single image. Over on the kind of comic book side, we've got a couple different things here. And comic books versus, say, the comic strip, you know, changes the format a bit. We have bigger, taller pages. We have more pages. So the action can take place over a period of time within one single issue. Generally, in an American comic, it's about 22 pages, not counting the ads. But we still kind of read it from, again, left to right, top to bottom. This is Jiro Taniguchi's The Walking Man. And this has been mirrored. Yeah. Is it mirrored? Yeah. So this is from Japan, and they went through the process of mirror imaging and printing it sort of backwards to what it was. And it's a very kind of simple comic. There's a lot of like action that takes place of this main character that kind of walks through Japan. But this is a great little sequence where, you know, he's running up the fire escape to the roof. And so the action doesn't always have to be like really dynamic and really kind of extravagant. It could be very simple and kind of quiet as well. But we have these, you know, kind of great moments of setting the scene of him and the action of him running up the staircase and like kind of what's happening with him personally, like he's sort of heaving and kind of in a panic.
Mark, is there a backstory to it? Because I don't get the comic in this at all.
So we're looking. So
he's running up the stairs and then he's resting when he gets to the top. I mean, what?
Yeah.
What's the story? What's the point?
Well, so we're looking at a single page within a larger comic. So the narrative takes place over, you know, 100 pages. So it's 100 pages of different information. So what we're missing is the stuff that's happening before it and the stuff that's happening after. So we're getting just a single kind of moment in time on this page.
What's the meaning of that first panel? Is that his clothes that he's dropping? Or what?
Yeah, yeah. So he's lost his jacket. You know, like he tossed his jacket to the side just for the sake of being faster. And up he goes.
So that must be the first...
this one here, yes.
The first sequence. And then he's up there without a jacket, right?
Correct, yeah. So we see him kind of ditching the jacket, kind of heaving, running, and then like we can see just the distance he's traveled. He's kind of approaching the end, and it's sort of like now that he's hitting the end, like we don't know what flight he's on here. And here we see that he's close to the top, and then as he gets closer to the top, the timing and the action starts to slow down, you know, like from here we see the top landing, and here we still see the top landing. So he's like, we're kind of out of breath and we're kind of like tired and exhausted from kind of this to this. And then this last panel, you know, we pull back really far, and then we, you know, we get this kind of more serene moment kind of taken away, like, or from the distance. And so there's a lot of similarity to, say, a comic strip to what happens in movie making with storyboarding, where they create like a sequence of events and basically shots of a movie. We kind of get the same thing here. Whereas a movie, they fill in the gaps for us with the action and the dialogue and the activity of the actors. In a comic, we have to make that bridge. We have to kind of figure out, well, here he is, and then this is the next thing, this is the next thing. And so we have to kind of complete the story ourselves. This is the same comic, just another point in time. And it kind of does something a little bit different. Here we have like just this weird panel of leaves. So what that's doing is it's setting the scene. It's kind of showing us like, here's the landscape. And then we get to see the characters engaged in that landscape. And then we see kind of the cast of characters of, you know, who's involved here. So we got a dog, a rabbit in the grass, and our walking man here. And so this first top portion of it is really just kind of like setting the scene. It's allowing us the space to understand who's involved. And here we've got him kind of realizing something. So even in these like kind of introductory moments, we have some bit of action. We got the dog that's made aware of something. We've got the rabbit, which is probably getting the attention of the dog. And we've got the man kind of also curious what the dog is interested in. And here we can see that, you know, he doesn't have glasses on. And so this next panel is blurry. And so he has to put his glasses on because, you know, he goes from not being able to see and it's blurry to putting his glasses on. And it's very slight, but there's like kind of fragments here that maybe we would pass up on the first glance. We would read this pretty quick. We'd be like, here he is looking, here's something blurry, puts the glasses on. And then we get this weird like punctuation here of this rabbit, and it's all fragmented and like broken. And so we look back and we're like, oh yeah, his glasses are broken. So that kind of, that tracks. You know, we can jump back in time and say, oh yeah, they gave us this information. They clued us in. And then he's confused, and we realize why. Like, he's sort of startled here. And we realize he's startled because the rabbit takes off. But again, you know, we're seeing this moment, this page, as one moment in time in a sequence of even more events. And so Taniguchi's great at these kind of fairly mundane moments and happenings, and presenting them in a way that's like a lifetime of information, just the way that our lives are. Like, we do something right now and we're going to go do something later, and we're going to go do something later. And so this comic kind of functions in a similar way. And so for this one, I was looking for a lot of comics that had less dialogue, just to kind of keep us all from like not having to read things, and instead just focusing on the way the images move the story along. So this is Frank Quitely, his thing from X-Men, and there's like no dialogue in it. And so just, we have this kind of like, you know, hospital scene with the two characters approaching whoever's sort of bedridden in this weird kind of futuristic chair. And you know, something's happening here. And again, we're missing kind of context and information before and after. But I really like the way that this does kind of a push in with the information, the way that the camera or the scene kind of functions like a camera, right? Like in our mind's eye, it starts to act like a movie, that we're at a distance and we're getting closer, and it becomes more intimate and more intimate. And then all of a sudden there's like this interruption, like this lady needs a drink before she gets to business. And then it kind of collapses even closer and even closer still. And so that's a really good kind of moment where we're moving from sort of the outside and then coming in. This whole comic is about, you know, these people that are like, that have special powers, and these are all like telepathic people. So there's going to be something that happens within the mind. So in the story, it makes sense, and there's some context here. But all of these events, all of these panels are related to that one moment, to that one kind of story that it's telling. much like Taniguchi's kind of tree in the first panel, this one is a lot different, or it's similar to that and different from the other ones. This is Mike Mignola's Hellboy, and I think I could fit. Can I fit it? There we go. There it is. All right, so this is the whole page here. And what's great about Mignola is he's really taken liberties with the way that the story is being told. And so he's more apt to kind of destroy the narrative structure that would normally take place. So in this quietly thing, you know, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like that's the order of things, and everything kind of takes place one after the other and informs each other. In this Mignola piece, here we've got the main character Hellboy coming in, like walking into a field with, you know, trees and a statue. And then we get the close-up of the statue, and then we see flowers. And if we go back, we're like, oh, that's what those white things are. So we get flowers. But then he gives us more flowers. And then he gives us a bird singing. And then he gives us this bird again, but not really saying anything. He has a speech bubble, but he stops singing. So it's creating, you know, the bird all of a sudden is silent, like it's something's happening. Now we have the flowers again, kind of the leaves or the petals rustling. And then we have this sort of like action that Hellboy here is kind of honed in on. He's made aware of something, and the bird flies away. And so this is not kind of moving the story along, except for maybe this and this. But all of these other panels is setting a mood. It's setting a tempo and a pace. And but it's not directly part of the narrative. It's giving us a moment outside of the action. And so much like the way movies do, if we think of, I don't know, I'm trying to think of like a moment in like The Godfather where Coppola kind of sets scenes and he kind of creates information beyond the main story. It functions very much like that, where these are sort of like cutscenes or like B-roll And it's really just creating a mood and creating an environment. So this is really great. And he does this a lot. He does these very kind of punctuated moments that are out of sequence. And these all kind of function differently than the way that, you know, that single image does. And so one of the things that I want to also talk about is the way that a comic book uses like those single moments as like, take a look at this. And so the covers of comics really kind of do a great job of like showing the dynamic action that could be in store inside of the issue. Whereas inside the issue, we get this long drawn out story. The cover has to convey a lot really quickly. It has to show you everything without spilling the beans, as it were. So in the cover of Amazing Fantasy, this is the debut of Spider-Man. It has to kind of show who he is. Like, here's a new character that you can read. Here's a new character that you can read. Superman, this is his first appearance here. So these kind of show off kind of the qualities of who this character may or may not be. But as we get to like experience these characters and grow with them and learn who they are, our expectation of them kind of changes. So this is Frank Miller's Batman from The Dark Knight Returns, and this is the cover for it. So he's taking Batman completely out of the picture and just giving us a silhouette. And so if we're familiar with Batman, then we're like excited by this image. But if we don't know who Batman is, then it's just like confusing and cryptic, which could be its own thing. This is a great splash page of a more current comic of a current iteration of the X-Men. And, you know, where it kind of builds on some of the ideas here. Here we have this action that's presenting, you know, Superman just smashing this car or Spider-Man grabbing this guy and swinging on his web. Here we've got a whole bunch of characters all engaged in this like dynamic action. You know, there's stuff happening all over. There's robots and four-armed creatures with guns and, you know, red blasts and pink blasts and fire and green stuff. And this guy's got all of the different colors going on. Wolverine, a different Wolverine than the more popular one, and then we've got dinosaurs, just all kinds of stuff, all kinds of like action and antics are in store. And so it kind of sells this idea like, pick this comic up and check out what's inside. I'm going to kind of like rush through this here at this point, but when we talk about comics, there's, you know, a lot of people involved in it. We've got writers and editors and letterers and colorists, but when we talk about the artwork, there's three people that we really kind of like distinguish. We've got the penciler, and that's the main artist. That's like the person that gets top billing with the writer. Then we have the inker, who is doing the inks, the finishing inks, on top of the pencils of the penciler. And then we have the colorist, who colors the image. But what's great is each inker is not just copying the image. They have a lot of input and a lot of influence on the way that the comic looks. And so there's this great video here where we look at a bunch of different inkers that worked with the same penciler. So Jack Kirby is one of the kind of biggest names in comic books. He created the Hulk and X-Men and Fantastic Four. And he's worked, he had a long career and he worked with a lot of different people. So this is a great video of seeing how different inkers changed the look of Kirby's work. So that's this. And when I'm talking about like inking and penciling, you know, that's that process. And those are the devices that are being used. So the penciler is working in pencil and the inker does things in black ink, and then that gets reproduced. And that's kind of the old technique. And so Gina was asking about, you know, do people still use traditional materials or do they use digital materials? And the answer is both. But this is a video on penciling and inking, so you get to see what that process is like. And then in the videos down here, there's sort of the difference between traditional methods and tools and digital tools. And so these are two short videos on how things are used both traditionally and digitally. And it's really quite amazing what they can do with the digital stuff. Like there's a lot of manipulation that can happen sort of in real time. But there's, you know, still the same kind of like functionality of that device. In these last couple pages, I just have some videos that introduce you to some of the bigger names in like the comic industry. You know, obviously comics have been around since, you know, for a long time, but like comic books really hit their peak in the 30s and kind of continued on outward from that moment. So these are just some really big names. So Jack Kirby, like I said, Mobius, who I've shown kind of previously, Katsuhiro Otomo, and then Will Eisner. And so these are just artists and videos that you can take a look at. And then for the comic strip side, we have Charles Schulz, who is responsible for Peanuts, maybe the most popular comic strip ever. Bill Watterson, who does Calvin and Hobbes, Gary Larson. And then I have some videos on the New Yorker cartoon. And there's just some fun videos here on that. And then just to wrap it up, I've got this video from Scott McCloud, or about Scott McCloud, and then an interview with Mike Mignola, who did the Hellboy comic.
Mark, where does the political cartoonist come into play?
You know, that's sort of kind of the beginning of cartooning. It was always political. Like, you know, when you look back at, you know, there's something I could look up. Hold on. Let me just find it here. I'll find it later. Political cartoons are, you know, very pointed and very kind of specific to the time and the place, but they've always had a role within the public, because that came into vogue, especially in the kind of 19th century. 19th century, because there wasn't photography. So the ability to kind of like critique the world at large relied on cartoonists to kind of draw these things. And so making caricatures and, you know, turning public servants into kind of buffoons has always kind of played a role within the public sphere. And so the political cartoons are, you know, kind of a mainstay to cartooning and are really important to kind of the genre and medium. And I'm glad you brought that up, because I should include that when I talk about cartoons and comics. But yeah, there's a long history of political cartooning, and I'll find some early examples when we take a break, and we'll look at that really quick. Are there any other questions about that? No. So comics are kind of a really interesting medium that usually gets maligned because we think it's the domain of like kids, but it's a very creative genre of art making. And you know, we looked at comic strips, which are generally humorous. We looked at comic books, which are kind of like adventure based, but there's more poignant stories. There's more important things that gets covered. You know, there's things about like romance and fantasy, but things that deal with very real world topics. And that's not just like the political kind of commentary, like Doonesbury or something. But we have comics like Spiegelman's Mouse, which is one of the books being banned in a lot of places. But it's a, you know, it talks about the Holocaust and, you know, Nazis, but does it in a very kind of amazing and adroit way. Like it's really well done. We have Persepolis, which is about a young girl growing up in, oh my gosh, I think it's Iraq. And then we have other forms of comics that are just like really kind of touching and poignant and deal with very kind of serious matters. And it's a great medium for that, because it allows sort of accessibility into worlds that maybe we don't normally get.
Graphic novels.
So there's
they're a huge... than a short story. Like, why do that instead of a short story? Just because it's briefer to do or quicker to do, or is there
I don't know that it's quicker, because you have to draw everything. But I think because the visuals matter, because you know, like as like a creative person, you know, maybe you don't just want to write something, you want to you want to tell the story, kind of showing the scope, showing the time difference and all of those things that comics do so well. And I think that kind of availability is the reason why. So yeah, it's a great medium to explore if you've never looked into it. There's a lot of stuff out there, you know, we've got a lot of history to read through. We'll go ahead and take a break here. We'll do 10 minutes and then we'll kind of shift gears and jump into the painting from last week. Okay. All right.
Mark, can I ask you a question?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I don't know if you got my email or not.
I did, yes.
Do you know if we take a picture of our work with a phone and then edit it by cropping it to, you know, take all the edges off, then is it impossible to embed it in the discussion?
So I think the problem you're running into is that because you've taken a few classes already, there's like a finite amount of space available on Canvas for each student. And So I think you would have to delete some of your old files to make space for the new images.
Huh. Well, I don't know how to delete them, but it won't even open, like on my end, on the computer, it doesn't.
Oh, really?
How do I explain it? I'm terrible with computers. It, like, if I pick it from photos, yeah. Like I hit upload on Canvas, then I go to my photos, find the image, but when I click on that, like to upload it, to add it,
yeah. It
doesn't give me the open button to even do anything.
Really?
If it's something that I've not edited that's in photos, I can do that.
Oh. Huh. Are you using, excuse me, are you using like a Mac or?
Yeah.
That's weird.
It's really weird. And then once in a while, like somehow I was able to give you send the assignment eventually. Yeah. But I have no idea what I did. I just kept hitting buttons.
I don't know. That sounds strange. I'll have to look into that a little bit more, but I'll try to figure it out and
Mark, get back to you. It's Lori. I've also suddenly in the last several weeks, when I have no problem loading stuff for critique, general discussion critique, but when I go to load for you, it doesn't have the same options that it did before. It's different. It looks different. I could do a screen grab if that helps you.
Yeah, please.
Okay.
I'm
on a Mac as well. And
I'll root around and I'll try to figure it out.
Know, I'm fully upgraded. I have the most recent Safari. I have a new system, so it's not Safari. I know that.
Okay. I know that there's been, I haven't read them, but they sent emails and I'm just like, they just sort of get tossed. But I know that there was some like things happening with Canvas, but I thought it was for like future classes, like they weren't showing up yet.
Registration.
So I don't know. I don't think that's related, but I'll look into it. And if you could send me any screen grabs that you might have, then that might help kind of figure out that problem.
And so in the meantime, Mark, I'm sending you the assignments if I can't upload them, but I can't add them to discussions for some reason unless.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I'll get on that and try to figure it out for you.
Okay.
Okay. So for the painting, I just want to do one more kind of just talk about the image here. And I looked at that website, Lori. That's pretty cool. I was actually thinking about something very similar to it.
Yeah, she's incredible.
But I'm really curious. I'm going to look into that more. okay, so this image here, one of the great things about working with like the image on the computer is we can like zoom in and like take a look at some of the stuff. One of the big things that we're going to be dealing with is just the color profiles of what we're examining here. And so what we could do is we could just start zooming in a lot and we could start to look at these colors here. And I think I just need a little bit more space. Sorry, just moving some things around. The zoom has me a little messed up. One of the things that you want to do is just figure out, well, what colors am I looking at? Like what's actually there? And so one of the things you could do is use your color wheel. It's here in front of my face, and hold it up to it and just see what family these colors exist in. Short of that, you know, I could do something like this where I can just make it like a square, and I could change these colors looking for whatever this color is. And I think it's in the red family, more muted than that. So this is like red violet here, right? Like this. So, and this is more kind of reddish there. if we move into like this area here, you know, this is cooler. So, you know, maybe that's more in the kind of violet. Again, muted. It's like we're going to have to neutralize these colors, but this is more kind of violet out this way. This one is kind of grayish, but also cool. So it could be violet. Maybe it's sort of in the like blue gray kind of family, like here ish. We look at like the highlight on her back here, that's very yellow. We've got some reds again, some violets, as we kind of make our way upward into her face. You know, we've got some greens here. And another thing we could do is just to check to see if there's anything white. So if we look at that highlight, we can see this is a white square next to that highlight here. We can see that that's not white. It's sort of in that kind of rosy, kind of peachy color. So maybe like right around here, lighter. Here, but grayish, right? If we go back to white here, we can see the white of her eye is not white. We've got some blues here, some bluish grays, some cool grays, some warm lights up through here. Over on kind of the shadow side, if we look at this, we've got some like greens, kind of muddy greens. Or reds, so like green and red together. But I'm picking up some greens through here in like this area. Some violets again in the shadow. So my palette is pretty diverse here. And if we look at her hair, we got some cool grays, some bluish grays out through here, maybe blue green. Out there, along with like the reddishness of her skin. And then for the black part of her hair, I'd probably make my own. And to do that, I would mix like a burnt umber and ultramarine blue together. And that gives me a good analog of black without being too heavy and dense in terms of that color. So my color profile is mainly in the reddish family, and that kind of tracks. There's some greens here that I'm gonna pick up on, some violets in kind of the shadow areas, some red violets. Every color is gonna be more neutral than like that color swatch on a color wheel, but that's my game plan. Right. Most
Mark,
likely I will not be able to
Photoshop, Mark.
Oh, that was just a preview. So I was just looking at, I was just zooming in on preview.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Yeah. Cause I'm in Photoshop and I was trying to figure out how to do that in mind. So thank you.
I mean, it's the same thing. Like if you made like just a square object, but this is kind of quick and easy here. So I probably won't be able to finish the painting within one session. So I'm going to work on it kind of outside and kind of show the completed work. I am doing the front view for the beginning class, and I'm working on that currently. So this is the stage that I'm in right now for that painting. There. And I don't have too much further to go. I do want to go deeper in the values, but it's pretty close. All right. Here is this three-quarter view drawing. Let me kind of shift here and hide myself. Okay, so here's my image. And then for my colors, I'm using two paint this time around. I've got brown. This is raw sienna, kind of like a yellow ochre. I've got magenta. I have magenta and yellow, some phthalo green, some, what is this, manganese blue. I can put some violet out, actually. I do want to put a little bit more violet out. Okay. And then I also have some Dulf blue over here and a little bit of white. I think it's dried up, but there it is. So that's my palette. I think kind of to start off with, I could just lay down a pretty basic kind of light wash of color. And, you know, I've got the highlight here. I've got some highlights here and highlights here. And actually the color of this is the same as her eyes. So that's what I'm seeing, like in her ears as well. So what I could do is I can mix out like a really kind of pale pink, muted color and just start blocking some of that in. So I'm gonna work kind of lighter to darker. I'm just spraying my palette down with some water just to help loosen up the paint a bit. Okay. If I don't finish this in this one session, I will continue the painting and complete it. And then post that as needed. All right, obviously her face isn't this pink, so I have to like bring this down a lot. And I could add the complement, which is green, to this, or I can add brown to it, which is already a neutralized color. So I'm gonna opt for adding brown to this. And that's going to help neutralize that color, but still keep it within the family that I want. I can keep going a little bit more. I'm gonna test this out. I think in this case, I will try adding a little bit of white paint. Yeah, I like that. So just a little bit more white paint in there. And what I'm doing right now is I'm just mixing my color and I'm comparing it to my image. And then I think it needs a lot of water. And I'm just trying to get into the same range of color that I think it needs to be in. It's a little heavy. Okay, so if I were to like kind of wipe this out and not be super loaded, you can kind of see how pale that color is right there. Right, I just did a little test right there. So if I water this out, it's gonna give me kind of the pale pink that I'm looking for. So I'm just gonna pick up a lot of water right now and kind of make a new pile of this. A lot of water. More water. Really, really pale. Barely any color on that. Yeah, there you go. So it's just barely registering some color, and that's where I want to be, because I'm going to jump into this and just kind of paint these areas. All of these highlighted areas here have that kind of pinkish, grayish color. And the reason I'm doing this is I want to jump away from any white area right now. Like, I just want to get rid of it and kind of move my paint around. Because this is kind of the lightest color that I have, I'm not too worried about where I'm painting it, anything. I just don't want this, like, that buildup. So I'm just going to kind of use a clean brush to kind of get any of those, like, areas where it overlaps and kind of builds up to just disappear.
A little bit like an underwash? Or...
Yeah, exactly. So it's just...
I have a question on that too. I understand what you're doing there, but do you not see a general underwash tone for the whole face, perhaps?
I could do that, but it's really not going to serve me any purpose at this point. Okay. Because I'm going to jump right into some darker values in the next, like, two steps.
I see. I'll wait.
So, rather than, like, waiting for, like, a lot of paint to dry, this kind of, mm-hmm. like, just expedites that process a bit.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So that kind of gives me, like, a nice baseline for that. There's like this highlight here along her neck that is more blue than pink, so I'm going to leave that for a little bit later. One of the things that I'm also doing is I'm squinting it down. I'm looking at the image and just trying to, like, determine, you know, where I'm at, like, where these opportunities of this color exist. So maybe just here a little bit more, kind of into the hairline. And I think that's pretty good. All right. This color on my palette is way too intense still. So I need to like start to mute this out really quickly. Because she has darker skin, she has a darker complexion. I'm not going to be afraid of pushing that value. If I kind of am a little bit timid, it's going to take me forever to get to that point where she actually has the complexion and value that she actually has. So I have to kind of jump in, and I have to be willing to make some of my colors darker and more muted and just paint what it is that I'm seeing. So I've got this here, and it just needs to go browner. So I just have to, you know, kind of put a big brown blob on my paint there. So that's just a browner color.
Did I miss what your palette is right there? What's the red and what's the brown you're using?
Okay, so the brown is, this is Van Dyke Brown, and okay. This is magenta.
Thank you.
So this is pretty good. You can kind of see I did a little test right there. The other thing is, don't be afraid of opportunities to find color where color exists. You know, especially when we're dealing with a portrait, we tend to steer a little towards the safe side. So we're thinking like tans and brown colors. And if we do that, it tends to lack the luminosity and richness that is actually present. So you have to find the opportunity for color when it presents itself. So if, in this case, if her skin is dark brown, we have to know which way it's veering. And for her, it's like kind of reddish or violet at times. And so I have to push those colors in more than I normally would, than you might normally do. All right, so I think that's good. And I think that's enough paint, so we'll see. Okay.
Mark, how did you transfer your drawing? Did you free draw it, or did you actually, use a projection?
So this one was a projector.
It kind of looked a little like a projector drawing.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah.
And just. I was wondering about her earring and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Do you sometimes, like if you have a color like that, that you know is going to contrast with everything else, kind of get, you know, like you did with the highlight, paint it in just so you can paint around it, or?
I do feel like it's a simple enough shape. It's not overly complex. That I can paint around it right now and then paint back into it when it comes time to do the yellow, because it's not just this, it's also the negative space around her head that has that same color profile. So for now, you know, I'm just gonna kind of paint in the negative space around the earring, rather than like change my palette, you know what I mean? So, yeah. All right. So maybe a little more water to this. I could always go darker. It's harder to lighten things up if need be. All right. A safe bet for me is to maybe work in the hair. Like she's got some skin exposed between her braids, so I feel like that's a good area, and that's kind of the color that's working like right through here. And I'm just trying to find it, this one and this one. Okay, that's heavy. Got a lot of paint on my brush. So I think I can go like, I watered this down maybe a bit too much, but I mean, it's a good kind of like beginning color. And I do feel like I'm in the right family. That's a great here. Is it this one?
So in this step, are you not painting where the other color is? This is like a totally different area you're painting.
This color, so the color that's happening here is happening here, but I wasn't sure that I have the right color. So to kind of hedge my bets, I'm painting out here where it's maybe less consequence if it's the wrong color. And then if I needed to adjust it, then I could adjust it before I apply it to like kind of the main area.
So if you feel that this is the correct color, then at some point you'll kind of color over the reddish.
Yes. Well, I'm gonna paint like, you know, this reddish color is really about this highlight and it's about these smaller highlights. But this color is like the majority of her kind of skin tone, like a lot. And I'm gonna jump right into it once I do a few more of this. I think this one here is the main area. And I'm getting a little there. Okay. So I'm seeing like just kind of tracking and trying to figure out where it is. This one here. This one here. Okay. So it's like this area. Into kind of here, and I'm going to use this like technique where I'm going to take my brush and wipe off the paint and use just that like water to help soften that edge a little bit into this. Try to move this paint around a little bit faster so it doesn't all settle in one kind of spot. Yeah, I could do her eyebrow as well because it's pretty dark into her forehead. So like her forehead is like this area here. I'm getting some of that softness out this way, but I'm just going to block all this in right now. And over here, it's all pretty dark, so I'm going to go a lot darker than where I'm at right now. So I can just come in here and just make sure that I maintain any of the lighter shapes that I've already laid down. So that's that pink that I have. Into her nose, her lips. The lip here, it does have some kind of lighter area right there, so I don't want to paint that too much. And then down her bottom lip also has a little bit of lightness into her chin. And then like here. Out here, right, into her there. Open that one out. To some of the information here on her ear. And really, all I'm really doing right now is just painting this kind of light medium color around the highlights. Because there's still that next darker value that needs to kind of drop in. There's the nose, that nose. All right, so now I'm going to clean my brush and just use the water to kind of attack the just this hard edge that I kind of created in some places and just soften and blend those things together where I feel like maybe it's a little too harsh. And I'm just pushing the paint around, kind of scrubbing here on the forehead, just kind of scrubbing that sharp edge away. I feel like that one there is also problematic. Where else? There. And what else? Maybe go through here. There's a little bit of like kind of color that happens through the hair occasionally. So I just want to maybe pick up some of that. Just indicate that it's there. Okay, cool.
Mark, in this approach, will you be doing any wet into wet, or is that not the style that you're going to use at all in this painting?
Yeah, I'm not going to do any real wet into wet painting for this. Okay. It's more like overlays of color, so like glazing it on.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So I'm just looking at my progress. I do feel like this is weird. What's happening there? What's this? This just has to go darker. Yeah. Kind of ran out of paint here. A little bit right there. Okay. We'll clean some of those like blobs up a bit. All right. Cool. What's her neck doing? You know, just for the sake of having some color down there, so it's not just like this floating head, I'm just gonna apply some of this down through here, just so we kind of indicate that we've got this stuff going on. That's more yellow over here, but this is kind of on that kind of pink side over this way, so that's fine up through here. And that right there. Cool. All right, so now the next thing for me is to just keep going and pushing the value and color that I need. So so I got this one here, but I'm gonna need more paint than this. So let's mix out some more. make a big pile of it. Red, brown, more brown. So that's not quite doing the trick. I feel like the brown is already sort of in the red family, so I need to kind of go a bit further. So I'm adding some phthalo, and that was a lot. That was a lot of phthalo green.
I was going to ask about the green and the maybe blue.
Yeah. So I think there's a little too much blue in that phthalo, so it kind of pushed it violet. So I just want to knock that down. I could use yellow, but I have this like, it says raw sienna, but I'm going to call it a yellow ochre, which is sort of yellow brown. Maybe a little more. Too much. And just a touch of red, just to kind of bring it back within the red family. Oh, that might actually be okay. Oh, that's so heavy though. Yeah, I need a lot of water in this guy. I'm gonna make a new pile actually. It's a little on the violet side, so I think I want to add maybe a little more brown to that. Maybe just some pure yellow now. So much. That's the one thing about like this tube paint for me is like when I'm working with it like this, when I'm just stuck it on the palette, it always sticks to my brush more than I'm used to. Okay, that's pretty good. So I got this really, really heavy one. I've got this one, which is also pretty, pretty dense. You can see how dark that is. Let me kind of do a test strip there. So I clean my brush off.
Mark, do you still have white in your red? So it's
I've got the white down here. Uh-huh. And that was mainly for sort of those light values that I just laid down. This right. One now I'm not adding white to it.
Okay. So it'll be more transparent.
It'll be more transparent, yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
I think I'm ready for this. All right. It's kind of the same thing where, you know, I'm just gonna work in the hair for a little bit just to double check and make sure. Kind of the same color, honestly. It's weird. I mean, I guess it's not that weird. I'm mixing it out. Yeah, okay. So now this is going to be kind of darker because I'm overlaying it and it is transparent. So it's going to start to show some of those colors underneath. Again, I can't be afraid of building up the value where it needs to go. One of the things that I can do is if I squint at my drawing or my painting, I can see that it's really, really light, right? Like what I've laid down is very light. If I squint at the source image, I can see that, you know, she's got some real dark values on there. So I need to get there. I need to like be willing to kind of commit to that and not be afraid of it, which is a scary proposition, but is what needs to happen. I'm going to start right here. I'm going to include her eyebrow with this because that's just going to help kind of block in. Her eyebrow is more like bluish brown, but this gives me some kind of indicator of where things go. I don't want to be too tight with this information just yet, but I kind of started in a spot that forced it. Yeah, that's fine. So I'm just gonna like use the paint that I have on there. I'm gonna go back and forth between like the water and slide that paint around. No, that's too much. I just gotta commit. Yeah, that's fine. Oh man, I kind of messed that one up. I gotta clean that off. So I put the paint in the wrong place. So I'm just gonna grab a clean brush and I'm just gonna use that brush with some water to lift that paint up and out. There you go. Where's your nose at? It's this one right here. So I am planning on a darker value beyond this as well. Just so everyone's kind of aware of what's happening. You know, her lip is kind of this color too. She's wearing really sheer makeup. So I just have that darker shadow that's happening that I'll need to pick up on. So I'm just like figuring out where things go. So the dark value. What is that? That's weird. It's here. And like this. Here, like this. Into this side here. Okay. Good. There's something happening here. Just don't know what it is. I think I gotta wipe that off. sort of like, there you go. Good. A softer blend. This is that. That's there. This needs to go dark here, so that's okay. This is also pretty dark, but she has a little highlight there. Into like the middle area of her forehead. So. A little more paint than that. I'm going to soften that out here in a second with just a little bit of clean water. Just break that edge up. Bit out here. Back into some of this like smaller work out this way and then onto her nose. Oh, it's a highlight, it's a highlight. The shadow side there. Shadow there. Shadow along the top of her nose. That. Underside of her nose, like that. Getting a little of this sort of color out here into kind of this area here. And just the beginnings of it right there. This is a little too light, so I need to come in here and just take a bit of that information with me. And it's going to go darker there. Along the temple, it needs more to that area here, and maybe out this way as well. So I'm just kind of scrubbing that paint a little bit to soften that edge, trying to clean my brush off and use what's there and whatever moisture is on my brush to kind of create some shifts in the information. This can go, squinting at it, this is a little too light over here. It needs to, like, I like what I did, it just needs to carry over more. So I just gotta keep building. That line up a little bit. There. There. That's okay. Maybe this right here, because of that. Good. What's her eye? What's that? A little bit more there. Or here. There's this one kind of like value, like right there. That kind of goes between this light area and this light area here. So I need to frame that a little bit better. Just come in just a bit darker here along the side of her cheekbone. Getting a little too saturated here. I might have to just wait and kind of revisit that.
Mark, what paper are you using?
This one, I think this is the last of my Artist Loft paper that I was using from before. Let me, I haven't thrown it away yet. Just this paper there. Yeah, but I'm all out of that. So I'll be shifting over to something different on the next painting.
Thank you.
Sure. This here needs a little attention. I feel like it's too blank right there. So just a bit more kind of careful painting inside of here. Because really, this is just a small kind of highlight there. So I want to just come in and just get that. That's good. I'm using a big kind of clumsy brush for this. And that kind of keeps me loose. Oh man, I just put my hand through that. There you go.
We're seeing green. You don't attack those areas with an underwash, but you'll come in later with
Well, maybe once I establish that like fourth value, the darker value, then I'm going to start to adjust some of those colors. I'm going to come back in and kind of jump back and forth between some of that value work and color. There is, up here, it does get a little kind of like khaki colored green. So rather than having it look like a monochromatic painting, I want those color profiles to start to exist and kind of liven up the skin a bit. So that'll kind of happen as I get past this next value. Because I will say, like, while it has some value right now, it's still not where it needs to be. It still can go darker. So I'm being a bit timid. And that kind of affords me some room to make adjustments in color as well.
Are you gonna do the whole thing realistically?
Not necessarily realistically, but more like painterly, I feel like is maybe the right approach to this. I'm not gonna be kind of fussing over every single instance. Instead, I'm looking to kind of record the information in a way that's true to the spirit of the image. That's sort of like a fancy way of saying not realistic, but more painterly and inventive at times, but still based on the photo. All right, so, oh man, this guy dried up already. Oh, this guy. Oh, okay, so I got this dark value now. Same family. And I can start to jump into that. So I'm just looking and trying to figure out where it needs it, where it doesn't. Pretty dry. No, that's wet. All right. Oh, heavy. That's my hand on the painting here.
Mark, I also have a question. This is Krista. Wouldn't you have at this stage started with the hair to get enough contrast and then put your other values into the face?
Yes, I mean that is a great idea. I think I'm doing it this way mainly because I have the color out and I'm sort of actively mixing it. The hair is not simple, but it's not as involved as other, it's less colors happening in the hair. So I do feel like I can kind of get to that moment pretty easily, or I feel confident about getting to there. And while it's not, say, per se, black, it's reading as maybe the darkest thing, just like her eyes and her eyebrows and the nostrils and some of the creases in her mouth. So I feel like I know where it needs to get to in terms of the level of value. So I don't feel too afraid of kind of reaching that.
Mark, any suggestions on how to change a mouth from the source image to that's smiling to be closed? Because smiling is just impossible to do for me, at least.
you could use another source image to kind of fill in the gaps.
Okay.
Have them take another picture and then you'll be able to sort of see what that looks like.
And then differences, just some basic differences of a man's mouth versus a woman's mouth, like the lips and stuff.
You know, I don't, everyone's got like a different shaped mouth. So I don't know that there's any sort of distinguishing characteristics between, say, a man and a woman. I think maybe obviously like the structure is going to shift depending on the person. But also like facial hair, that's a sort of a good indicator if that's there. Color-wise, I think there's a lot of color that is generally available. And I think like males usually have more color on their face than females, like naturally. And so even if like there's no makeup involved, there's still a lot of color. So for like men, there's generally color that is there that maybe we're not thinking is there, because, you know, we tend to like think that it's in the domain of like makeup, but there's a lot of color that is kind of available. I'm sorry, I was like kind of like walking and chewing gum.
not something I can do. Thank you.
Sure. But I did have a point, and I think I got there. all this like, oh wait, wrong pile. All this tiny work to kind of jump into. That's looking pretty good. That's looking pretty good. It's like this area here. And I know that I'm painting kind of like really tight and fine. That's just because I'm close up to this, but I'm really trying to think about approaching this as like broad strokes. I don't want to be overly detailed before I'm ready for it. Got this like really defined kind of like underside of her cheekbone here. It's not super dark, but it's there. I just want to maybe get some of that structure in. A little more value through here. Value through here. And so having both of these piles is kind of nice, so I can build up and kind of fuss around a little bit between those two. Kind of knock this line down a little. Kind of build up there too. Too much paint. Too much paint still. Something happening here. I just don't think I'm in the right zone here. Yeah, more value right there. A little weird. Yeah, that's working. It's okay. Her lips. Too much. Just a little bit of a halo here. And for the time being, just because it's so, to me, it's so weird when like the eyes are just like blank like that. I can use this dark value to like block in kind of the darks of the eye area. Some shadow here as well on the other lip, and that's going to help kind of push the lip back in space so it wraps around her head rather than kind of feeling like a cutout. There's more value over here too. Good. I'm just going to jump around my palette here just to kind of soften some stuff out. It's a little more value right there. Good. And so while this looks pretty monochromatic, and it kind of is right now, I can shift gears at this point and start to work on some other information before I kind of jump back into the rest of the painting. So this would be a good opportunity to maybe work on some of the hair a little bit, but definitely this negative space. And we could see what that color shift is about to do when I jump into the negative space. So. I've got about 30 minutes left of class, and what am I seeing here? What am I like observing? I could go darker. I feel like squinting it down, it's a little like this area here is a little too light. And so I can build up that value a bit further. This area here is also a little too light, so I could build up that value further. I think I can go darker right in through here as well to just sort of knock down some of those highlights and really commit to that value. So I'll do that as time permits. But what I want to do right now is jump into this negative space. And I can work on that earring at the same time because they're both similar in palette. When it comes to a gold object, and actually let me grab another painting that I have here. When it comes to a gold object or anything metallic, what we're really seeing is not that it's the color gold, but we're seeing that it has a lot of available values that are like distinguishable. And we don't get maybe the same blend that we would normally get across the surface. So in this ring that I was painting, you know, my palette is really like white, yellow, like this pale yellow, this slightly darker yellow, this muted yellow, and then black. And so really it's like five colors, maybe four colors with one like overlaid on top of itself, the yellow. So either like the pale versus the more intense. But I have very distinct shapes where like the yellow butts up against the like yellow ochre, and it butts up against the black, and it butts up against the white. And we see that happen with her earring. We get this like distinct shape, and that kind of creates that reflection, and it creates the effect of you know, like the sparkliness of jewelry. So generally it's like black, white, and yellow ochre. So I've got the yellow. I don't need white because I have the white of the page. But I'm just gonna start with some of this yellow, and it's a pretty intense color. But it's slightly dull. So I'm gonna pick up just a touch. Because this is sort of a brownish yellow, I'm just going to pick up a touch of that just to knock that down a bit. So that's a good kind of second color. So I just have this one. There you go. That's good. So I'm going to do this kind of quickly and reduce it out to some simple shapes and colors. So I'm just going to do all the what I feel is this more yellow color first. That. So not a lot of blending. It's more just like distinct shapes of color. I'm just going to pick up a little bit more of this sienna. I want a distinct color shift here. Is that good? Maybe a touch of violet. I want to dull this out just a bit more. So much. There you go. That's good.
Think it gives more jewelry effect with the kind of detailed fragmentation rather than an underwash.
Yes, yeah. Because what we're trying to do is like create the reflectiveness and like shininess that's happening in the jewelry. And you know, contextually, it'll read like what it's supposed to read because, you know, it's kind of goldish in color and it's on an ear, so it's going to be an earring, so it's going to look like the thing that it should look like. And then I have like maybe a dark color, and maybe I'll just use this violet here. And some of this brown, just mix those two together. I guess I just made that color. I should wait. It's still a little like that yellow ochre color. It's a little watery, so I don't want to have them intermingle. I want that very deliberate edge to all my shapes. For the earrings, so yeah, let that dry for a second. Put some yellow in there. It's going to be a little more yellow over there, a little more yellow over here. And that's that. Or yellow here, and more yellow here, and more yellow right there. That edge down just a touch. Ooh, that's a lot of paint. Oh, what was that? Where did that blue come from? I had some some paint there. That's a mistake. Too much water. I'm just going to come in here just to continue some of these values up and through. So I'm gonna jump in and just continue my train of thought with this one thing. I realize I don't want this much violet here on my palette. I'm gonna wipe that up now. And I need to mix more of this sort of yellowy gold color. So there's that. Together. More of that. That's a lot. It's clean.
This is for the background. Huh?
This is for the background, correct? Yes. I might not have enough paint. We just keep mixing a little bit more. It's a lot of real estate here.
Are you finished with the earring?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I can always go back if I feel like it needs something.
It seems a little bit fragmented to me.
I mean, yeah, a little bit, but I think that's fine with me. Like, I don't think it's going to get confused for something else. I'm not too worried about this because the dark of her hair will cover up this yellow if need be. I'll try to keep this somewhat fluid.
Any reason why you haven't done her hair?
Just because I haven't mixed out that color yet. Okay. but I'll get to it here in like a few moments.
Probably is the right decision to do the background and then the hair.
Yeah. I feel like this will allow me the opportunity to kind of adjust colors as needed.
Mark, do you do all your portraits so detailed, like paint by number, or is there some time you just go in and sort of feel your way through, or do you?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. There's opportunities to kind of like paint and just like find it and invent things as you're going along. I think the reason that I'm doing it in this manner is because it, you know, for students, you want to learn how to do things accurately. And so this is a kind of a great technique for that. That kind of paint by numbers approach.
Yeah, I find it very difficult.
Yeah, I mean, it is, you know, portraiture is one of the hardest things to really tackle in terms of like subject matter. And so, you know, it's not like you're going to get it the first couple times you try it. You know, it's going to take practice and practice and practice. There we go. Sorry, I'm just sort of.
I have to applaud your patience.
Being right? Incredible. Mark, this is Lori. I have some of the shimmer paints in watercolor. Like I have a ruby, a blue, a bronze, and gold. Might be interesting to try painting her portrait with those paints and see what happens.
Oh, mixing,
yeah. Possibly mixing other color into it, you know, that aren't the shimmer.
Yeah, you know, I think one of the things that we tend to do when we paint is we tend to be kind of safe with the information. Again, thinking about it like skin is brown, or, you know, apple is red. And really there's a wealth of color that is available to us. And I think like it's important that we kind of approach it in that way. That's like, what opportunities do we have to build color into the portrait or into the painting, whether it's a portrait or not? Just, you know, color is fun, but it's also very frustrating and very confusing and complicated. So the more color, I always feel like the better. You know, it doesn't have to be photo accurate, unless that's what, you know, you're getting paid for. But if it's a painting for yourself, I say, why not explore color? Why not try to get more out of the image than you would normally expect to? So if you have like iridescent paint or something with like some texture or additive in it, that's always kind of an exciting proposition. All right, so looking at this, we're kind of like right at that moment here. This color doesn't feel so crazy now to me. Like it's still kind of on the purple violet side. So I can do some adjustments to that, but it doesn't feel monochromatic all of a sudden. And I think when I come in with the dark of the hair, that'll really kind of coalesce and make it feel even more kind of like colorful rather than a monochromatic painting. And then I will kind of enter into some of the more kind of greenish, dull colors here and here on her forehead, some here on her nose, just to add some definition and some just added color to kind of gain more opportunities. I'll keep working on this, and when I complete it, I will have it posted to the module. But I'm also, like I said, working, or like I showed you at the top of the demo, I am working on the other front view portrait as well. And so I'll post both videos. So this video, as well as the video for the beginning class. So if you want to see the process for that painting, you can watch that process as well. And I'll post both finished images with steps in between. So I'm going to go grab lunch, but I'll do the hair and I'll post the picture of the hair. I'll post more pictures of like color and then the finished thing. So then.
This is Nancy. I have a quick question. If you're investigating with MiraCosto about classes and videos and stuff, do you know if your videos are just going to be proprietary to MiraCosto, or might they be available to us as, you know, former students to look at them like during the summer?
So from my understanding, you do have access to Canvas for like a calendar year. I may be wrong about that, but what I can do is I can upload the videos to my YouTube page. It'll be a lot of videos to kind of download and then upload, but I'll do that, and then that way they're available. Because I would like to keep these videos as well, so I think it's...
Yeah, that'd be really helpful.
Great yeah. news. Thank you.
A lot but of work. I'll kind of get on that. So.
We can't trust Canvas. So yeah. We'd rather have the control. You're talking about the videos of your class videos, the recordings, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Oh, Mark, so, that'd be so great.
I mean, as far as I'm like, as far as I know, I'm the person that made it. So even though it maybe is Miracosta's like
platform
stuff, it's my intellectual property. So I think I can post it as I like. So I feel I should be able to do that. And as long as, you know, I don't make any money on it, then then I don't think Miracosta is going after me.
And could you put a link to YouTube in an email maybe or something?
Yeah.
Thank you.
And Mark, can you repost that image of this person you're painting right now?
Oh, yes. Yes, I can. Please? Yeah, I'll throw it in the chat right now.
So Mark, I kind of missed that. How are you going to send those to us? Are you going to send that to us via email, or where will you post all of your lessons that we've sat through this semester?
I'm going to download them and then upload them to my personal YouTube page.
Your personal YouTube. Okay. So you just go into YouTube and type in your name and then you'll come up and then we can watch them there. Is that what you're doing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Should we subscribe to your YouTube or?
Sure. I mean, you can. I have like kind of crazy videos of like me skiing or biking as well. So, but I'll put them all together in a playlist of like watercolor instruction class. Mm-hmm. So that way you're not like having to search through everything.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I do have a question. So the bottom left and right corner that you kind of left blank, is that because you're going to do the dark
value? Yes, correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
That kind of follows that circle.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And did you figure out the color that you're going to do or colors you're going to do for her hair?
I'm going to keep it kind of in the you know, brown family, but what I'm going to do to kind of create the black for it, like the quote unquote black, is I'm going to mix my Delft blue here with some of that what is this Van Dyke brown, and that's going to give me a really, really dark color. If I have more brown in it, it'll be warmer. If I have more blue in it, it'll be cooler. So it's not as like dense and as dull as a black paint would be, but it'll allow me some kind of latitude in terms of temperature and just some color range. So just blue and black, or I'm sorry, blue and brown is going to make that like blackish color. And that's going to keep me in sort of a colorful family of hues.
Thank you.
I think it's coming along. I feel like this is pretty nice so far. You know, it still is a few steps away from really coming together. We can kind of see, let me just sort of move my palette off page off the screen here. So I got these two, and we'll just, you know, put them separate.
Mark, aside. Could you put that original bet in the chat also of that straightforward lady?
Oh yeah, sure. That is here too. Yeah.
Hmm.
So there you go. So kind of like similar points of kind of finish on both of these. This was what, 2 hours? This was 2 hours as well. I tend to be a little long-winded with the contents in the module. But I feel like they're both coming along. So I'm excited to see how they how they turn out. I'm excited to see how your work turns out as well. That all said, portraiture again is one of the toughest things. It is really challenging. Harder if it's someone that you know. But don't despair. Like, keep at it. The more you do it, the easier it gets. I mean, even for me, like this was like kind of a daunting task. I was like a little nervous about, can I do this? Can I like do it in front of everyone? And it's on the right track. So I'm pretty happy. But there's still mistakes that I made and still mistakes that I can kind of fix and remedy. So I'll be going through and working on it more. And, you know, that should be sort of like all of you too. Just don't be afraid of the mistakes, you know, be willing to make them, be willing to kind of like work through them. And I think that's where we want to be. Any other questions before we wrap things up?
Thanks for doing a portrait in this, in part of the class structure. I really appreciate it, Mark.
Yeah. I think it's a, you know, it's an important thing to kind of introduce, and you know, it's one of those things that takes a lifetime to perfect. So I try to cover as much as I can in 2 weeks. All right, Al.
You're doing
have a great weekend,
Mark.
And I'll see you all on Wednesday. Next Wednesday.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, Mark.
You have a good weekend too.
Thanks, Mark.
Bye. Bye.